فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما ينفعنا، ولا تجعل فيما علمتنا وبالا علينا. إن شاء الله تعالى we're now going to start the fourth book. Is this the fourth book? We're going to now start, inshallah, the fourth book in the Barnamij, the program which we named Dabtul Ilm, Precision in Knowledge. We previously finished Thalathat al-Usul, Al-Qawa'id al-Arba', Nukhbat al-Fikr, and inshallah ta'ala, this is going to be the fourth book. Ta'zim al-Ilmi, since it hasn't finished yet, we're not putting it in the, we're not adding it to the counting of the books that we have finished. So if inshallah ta'ala, this is the fourth book. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He allows us to benefit from this book, and He also increases our knowledge in it, and that He doesn't make what we learn from this book a proof against us. Knowledge is beneficial, ya ikhwati al-kiram, when it has the thamara manifests on your limbs. And this is something a person whose heart is alive is always concerned about, that all of the knowledge he has gathered and all of the information he has taken on board, is it him just making it a hujjah against himself? This is something that we need to sincerely, honestly worry about all the time. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He doesn't make this knowledge a hujjah against me, and He doesn't also make it a hujjah against any one of you. My beloved brothers and sisters, this book, Al-Waraqat, is a book that deals with Usul al-Fiqh. It's a book that deals with Usul al-Fiqh. So what I'm going to do, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, is I'm going to give you guys all an overview of the book. So you have an overview of what this book is going to deal with, and then inshallah ta'ala we're going to get into the detailed information pertaining to it, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. This book, Usul al-Fiqh, Ama al-Waraqat, is categorized into four headings. It's categorized and it's broken into four chapters. Ama four headings, four main headings. And inshallah ta'ala later I'm going to ask you all, I've got some gifts and some books to give inshallah ta'ala. Since Usul al-Fiqh is a bit, it needs thinking and it needs consistent. I have to talk to you guys, you guys have to talk to me, so it can't be a one-way studying of Al-Usul al-Fiqh. The first chapter is an introduction. So if we can count that as a chapter, or should we say that's the introduction? We'll make the introduction. So we'll say the introduction and then three chapters. So the first one is Muqaddimah, it's an introduction. The book is going to go through an introduction. And in that introduction, the author is going to define for you Usul, and he's going to define Al-Fiqh, and then he's going to define them both together. So he's going to define Usul Al-Fiqh as a compounded word, and he's also going to define it individually. That's what he's going to talk about in the Muqaddimah, number one. Number two, the second thing that he's going to talk about in the Muqaddimah is Al-Ahkam al-Shara'iyyah, Al-Taklifiyyah. He's going to talk about the jurisprudent rulings. The jurisprudent rulings in the Sharia. And he's going to categorize that into two. The Ahkam in the Sharia are two types, and the author is going to mention them. The first one is Al-Ahkam al-Shara'iyyah, Al-Taklifiyyah. And whether we can use that term, Al-Taklifi, or not, we'll discuss it in the book, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. The second is Al-Ahkam jurisprudent rulings that are pertaining to al-wada', science. It's called al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-wada'iyya. And what that means in details, we're going to learn that inshallah ta'ala in the book. The first one, which is al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-taklifiyya, is five. The author is going to mention five of them. And it's the famous five that all of us know, which is al-wajib, al-mandub. The first one is al-wajib. The second one is al-mandub. The third one is al-tahrim, haram. And the fourth one is makruh. And the fifth one is al-mubah. All of those, the way that the author says, we're also going to do tahqib on him. That he uses the word al-wujub. So he uses the word wajib, and he shouldn't use wajib, he should use al-wujub. He uses haram, he should use tahrim. He uses mubah, he should be using al-nadb. He uses makruh, he should use karaha. He uses mubah, he should use al-ibaha. We'll speak about why he should use this. But all of those are five are what? Al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-taklifiyya. The author is going to speak about that, all of that in the Muqaddimah. That's the second part in the Muqaddimah. The third part in the Muqaddimah that the author is going to be speaking about, inshallah ta'ala, is... the second type of the ahkam al-shar'iyya is what? Al-wad'iyya, which becomes the third part. It's the third part, which is al-ahkam al-shar'iyya al-wad'iyya. The author mentions only two. But it's five. It's five, but the author only mentions two of them. And the author only mentions as-sahih and batil. He mentions as-sahih and what? Al-batil. We'll speak about the usage of the word batil, or is it correct to use al-fasid? We'll speak about the others that he has left, which is as-sababu, al-mani' and al-shart. So those are the extra two that he's missing, which is al-sababu, reason, al-mani', the prevention, and al-shartu, which is a prerequisite. Each of these words that I'm saying, if you write it down now, when the book comes, we'll go into each one properly and understand it properly. I just want you to have an overview before you go into the book. And that you have a proper understanding before we go into the information regarding the terms that the author uses. That's the muqaddimah, that's the introduction. Once the author finishes the introduction, he speaks about the adillah. He also talks about al-adillah, which is evidences. What's the evidence? Adillah, what's evidence? The author defines what the word dalil means. He gives you an understanding of what the word dalil means. And what he also does is that the types of dalil he mentions are categorized into two. It's categorized into what? It is categorized into two. The first one is called al-adillah al-asliyah. Al-adillah al-asliyah, original evidences. Al-adillah al-asliyah, original evidences. It's the foundational evidences, the fundamental evidences. And that is three. Al-kitabu, was-sunnah, wal-ijma'. That is al-adillah al-asliyah. Al-kitabu, was-sunnah, wal-ijma'u. Then the author goes on to the second type of adilla, which is al-adilla al-far'iyya, sub-branches. They stem from these three. They stem from the kitab and the sunnah and the ijma', they stem from it. And the author mentions from them qawlu al-sahabi, the statement of a companion, if it's a hujjah or not. He also talks about al-qiyas, analogy. Qiyas is also a what? It's a dalil far'i. And also there are others as well, which is shar'u man qablana, the sharia of the previous nations is an evidence for us. That's also another issue. Also saddu dhari'a, it's another evidence that people that are used, which is blocking off something that might lead to harm, or that might lead to something haram, closing the door that might lead to haram. It's called saddu dhari'a. That's also another form of evidence. Al-maslahat al-mursala is something that is beneficial. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't do it. He couldn't have done it. But we can do it. And there's a benefit in it. Are we allowed to do it? And is there evidence? Also, the other one is istishab. Istishab means leaving things at its original essence and taking the original essence as a dalil. Like when the ulama, they say, al-aslu fi shay, al-aslu fi kada, al-aslu fi kada. Asl, when they say it, means istishab. Biqa' ma kan ala ma kan. Letting something remain at its original state and using that as an evidence. Like for example, if I say your original essence is innocency until proven guilty, I'm not using no other evidence here, I'm just using istishab. This is another one. This is called like adilla far'iyya. The adilla asliyya is al-kitab wa sunnah wa al-ijma'. All of these are called adilla far'iyya, sub-branches. The third chapter that the author speaks about is dalalat. Dilalat. The dilalat is as it said, it's the backbone of usul al-fiqh. This is what usul al-fiqh deals with. Dilalat is the relationship between the evidence and extracting of the ruling from the evidence. The relationship between the what? The dalil and the madlul. The evidence and the thing you're using the evidence for. What's the relationship between it? Are you with me, brothers? I always bring this example. Somebody says, celebrating the Prophet's birthday is permissible. What's your evidence? أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Did he bring an ayah from the Qur'an? Yes, he's got a dalil asli. He's got a dalil asli, he's got a fundamental evidence here. What does he have? Al-kitabu. What is it that's missing from him? The dalala is wrong. The dalala is wrong. This chapter deals with this now. This is where you learn that when somebody brings you a dalil and he puts it forward to you, how to tackle it and how to deal with it. The dalalat is two types. Dalala qawliyah and dalala fi'liyah. Dalala qawliyah and dalala which is fi'liyah, right? The dalala qawliyah is categorized into four. And that's what this book deals with. This book talks about dalala qawliyah. Dalala qawliyah means verbal dalala. And it's four types. It's four types. The first one is al-lafdhu nafsahu. The letter itself has the dalala in it. The dalala is in the wording itself. So the first one is al-dalalatu nafsahu. The dalala is in the wording in and within itself. And two things are going to fall under that is al-amr wa nahyu, the commands and the prohibitions. The author is going to speak about that very well. What is al-amr? What's al-nahyu? We're going to see that inshaAllah ta'ala. The second one is Al-Madlul. And Al-Madlul means the thing that the evidence is being used for. All of these we're going to speak about it in extensive, detailed manner, inshaAllah ta'ala, don't worry. The madlul, which is that thing that the evidence is being shown with. And this, the scholars, they categorize it into four. Al-Ammu, general. Al-Khasu, specific. Al-Mutlaq, unrestricted. Al-Muqayyad, restricted. The author is going to talk about all of that. The third one is Kayfiyyatu Dalalatiha. The third one is Kayfiyyatu Dalalatiha. How does it show the Dalala? How? Are you with me, brothers? Kayfiyyatu Dalalatiha means how does it show the Dalala? How does it show this evidence? That's the third type of Dalalatul Qawliya, which is four. An-Nasu, Al-Zahir, Al-Mujmal, and Al-Mubayyan. And the fourth one, which in the Dalalat, the fourth one is the removing of the evidence, is the fourth one. It's called الدلالة ورفعها, doing رفع of the دلالة, removing this ruling. And this is called النسخ, abrogation. Abrogation falls under this one. النسخ, المنسوخ, ناسخ, المنسوخ. Which you all hear of. ناسخ and منسوخ, he talks about it here. Are you with me, brothers? The last chapter that the author is going to speak about, are you with me, brothers? That he's going to talk about is at-tarjih, at-ta'arud wa tarjih, when the textual evidences are opposing each other, how to reconcile between it and how to deal with those textual evidences. This fourth one, at-ta'arud wa tarjih. And when he talks about it, are you with me, brothers? He looks at it from two angles. The first one, he looks at the one who has got the right to do tarjih and has the rights to reconcile between the evidences and bring it together. Are you with me, brothers? This is going to be done by who? The mujtahid and the mufti. The author is going to speak about that in this chapter. The Mufti and the Mujtahid. And the Mufti, if it's spoken about, what's also going to be spoken about? The Mustafti, the one who's asking the Mufti the question. And he mentions some conditions for that as well. Author is going to also speak about an-nadharu ila al-dalil wa martabatihi, looking at the evidence itself and its levels. So if the evidences are reconciled, they're contradicting one another, and they need to be reconciled, and they seem to be contradicting one another, how to reconcile between it. The author mentions that we need to look at the evidence and its levels. So if it's one of it is mutawatir and one is ahad, or one is, we're looking at the levels of the evidences that are contradicting each other, the martaba. We'll see that inshallah ta'ala. Also, we'll look at the evidences that's contradicting one another. We're going to look at what it consists of. And also, we're going to look at other external factors that the author is going to mention inshallah ta'ala. So this is just a rough, very rough overview of this kitab al-waraqat. And inshallah ta'ala, if we're not able to finish it today, if it happens, then inshallah ta'ala, as I said to you, Saturday and Sunday will take a long day. Al-Qawa'id Al-Fiqhiyya by Sheikh Abd al-Rahman Nasir Sa'idi, which we'll be doing, is very small. The only book that's really left to finish, really, is this one, Ta'zim al-Ilm. That seems to not be moving much. The rest of the books, they seem like they're going according to plan. So inshallah ta'ala, the brother's going to read now and we'll try to explain what the author is saying. Having an understanding that this is an overview, a rough overview of what the book deals with. Now inshallah ta'ala, you're going to go into the book and you're going to learn it in more details regarding this particular point inshallah ta'ala. Yeah, the last one is ta'arud wa tarjih. Na'am, Sam.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa bihi al-i'ana wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad. Qala al-shaykh al-imam al-amil, al-alim, al-allama, al-war' al-zahid, imam al-haramin, Abu al-ma'ali, Abdullah ibn Abi Muhammad. رحمة الله تعالى رحمه الله تعالى هذه ورقات تشتمل على معرفة فصول من أصول الفقه ينتفع بها وذلك لفظ المؤلف من جزئين المفردين
مؤلف
من جزئين مفردين أحدهما أصول والآخر الفقه فالأصل ما يبني عليه غيره
ما ينبني عليه غيره
كالجدار والفرع ما بني على غيره والفقه معرفة الأحكام
والفرع what did it say for you والفرع ما يبنى
على غيره
so والفرع ما يبنى على غيره
والفرع ما يبنى على غيره والفقه معرفة الأحكام الشرعية التي طريقها الاجتهاد
the author رحمه الله he started his book with basmala بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم And then he mentions the Hamdalah. In the copy that the brother read from, it doesn't have the Basmalah nor the Hamdalah. Does it have the Basmalah? No, it doesn't have the Hamdalah. So it's different copies. The book has different copies. My copy says the Hamdalah and the Basmalah. The author starts by saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Then second thing he mentions is the Hamdalah. And then after that he also does mention the Salat on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the copies of the book is different, as I said. Different. Sometimes some copies, when I read it, it doesn't have it, so I say it doesn't have it. Sometimes when I do explain it, if I have the book that it has it on it, I explain according to that book. Because the book has so many different nusakhs. Very different manuscripts that it was taken from. This, which is Bismillahi, to start the book with, and then to mention the Hamdalah, and then to mention the Salah on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and on his family and his companions, These three is min adab al-tasnif ittifaqan. It's from the etiquette of when authoring that the scholars all agree upon. These three. Then the author, rahimahullah, he specifically specified the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam with the salah and the Prophet's family and his companions. He did not mention the salam. So he says, wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. He didn't say, وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ He didn't. And it would have been better if he combined between the two and said, As-salah and salam together. Then the author, rahimahullah, he says, فَهَذِهِ وَرَقَاتٌ This ضمير, which is هَذِهِ, this pronoun, هَذِهِ. The scholars, they say, the هَذِهِ, it's a pronoun. It's a ضمير, right? And what is it that he's pointing at? When you say هذه this, you should be pointing at something, right? So what is it that the author is pointing at? So they say it is one of two. If he had written the book first, and then once he finished writing the book, he then wrote the introduction, then what he's referring to is the book he wrote, which then becomes شَيْءٌ mahsus, a tangible thing. But which some scholars do that. They write the book, and then they go for the introduction. And that's the best way of authoring, anyways. Because in the introduction, you want to give the people an understanding of what you wrote already. So some scholars, they do that. Others, they don't choose to do that. They start their book from the introduction to the book. So where does the hadith refer back to now? If the book hasn't been written, and he goes hadith, it refers back to what's in his head. What he's got in his mind, the idea that he has. So from this angle, it becomes ma'anawi. It becomes something that's intangible. It's something that's in his head, which he wants to bring out. He's referring to this. هذه this. I mean, this was in my head. So the author says, فهذه this. ورقات. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he used the word ورقات, pages. The reason why he used the word ورقات is called ترغيبا في تلقي. ترغيبا في تلقي. The author did this so he can bring you close. Pages only, nothing big. So it's, when we're explaining the book, and we're going through the book, and the author clearly said pages, what is upon us to do is to treat it like pages and not treat it like it's a what? Volumes. When we explain it, we explain it very simple and very easy, that we don't go too much into details in it. And this method that he took is to basically place in the hearts of the students of knowledge, it's only little pages that you're going to go through. Be patient with it. It's nothing too big. It's trying to get you to what? To be driven. Waraqat. وَتِلْكَ الْوَرَقَاتِ تَشْتَمِلُ These waraqat تَشْتَمِلُ مَا مَعَنَا تَشْتَمِلُ تَحْتَوِي It consists of, it contains of what? عَلَى مَعْرِفَةِ فُصُولٍ مِنْ أُصُولِ الْفِقْهِ It consists of فُصُول A fasal. Are you with me, brothers? Is what falls under a what? Bab. When the scholars break down a book that they are authoring, they break it down in what? They break it down in the following. They say kitab, bab, fasl, masail. So it's kitab, bab,